Okay. Hi, everybody. I don't know if they can hear me, but I'm just gonna go for it. Okay, great. We had a visitor, so now it's Carrie and I here for my very first digital training. So I'm honored to be here, quote unquote, with you all. So I know that we had, my name is Dave Whitman. I'm the director of the Resource Center for Sexual and Gender Diversity. I know that we had a really great time. What was it, last spring? No, fall?
Last fall.
Last, so this past fall.
No, the year
Oh,
before.
wow. So we have been away from each other for a bit, but I know that we did have a preliminary training. So if there's anything throughout this part two today, which is focused specifically on transgender identities, that you have a question or a thought about, or you say, hey, can you rewind? I need a better refresher. Just chime in and let Carrie or I know, and we will get there. So, thanks for being patient as we move through this. So, through any discussion that I'm having, whether it be about trans identities in particular, LGBTQ identities broadly, I always want to start off and focus on this concept of empathy because, we're seeing in the media so much about trans people can't use certain bathrooms, and we're seeing all this rhetoric around, trans people are these villains, and there's a lot of concerns about people's safety around trans identities, and can people play on the right sports teams, and all of these other, discussions. But what I really want us to encourage our discussion today is that if you are not transgender in this hangout that we're having digitally, I myself am not transgender. I don't know what that's like. We can't know what that's like. And even for me, as someone who identifies as queer, gay, part of this larger community, it's my role to also lean into empathy, to really realize that the best way to really figure out the experiences people are having are to listen, to have empathy, and to be interconnected in the issues that people are facing in our world. So, why is the RCSUD focusing on trans identities in particular? Everyone deserves the right to feel safe, affirmed, valued, and respected at UCSB. When students fill out the application, which now asks for their gender identity, whether it be transgender, whether it be a man, whether it be a woman, something else, it doesn't have a drop-down menu that says, well, transgender students are more likely to not see themselves represented in the faculty, or they're more likely to have issues or concerns with being misgendered or in the locker rooms or in the bathrooms, but that is happening to our students. So we want to make sure that we're having a commitment from every level of campus life, whether it be from SIS&T to folks more on the ground working with students, that we can create systems, protocols, initiatives, and empathy moments for trans students to succeed. The presence of trans people on campus is crucial to the success of our institution. Trans people, faculty, students, staff have been, part of UCSB life since the beginning of the school's opening, and they don't have always, haven't always felt that they could be included. And how can they feel that way if we are not having policies and procedures and stances that are going to be affirming of who they are? And so when we say something like Black Lives Matter, right, it doesn't mean that other lives don't matter. It means we live in a society where, unfortunately, many people don't believe that Black lives do matter. And it's very similar and interconnected with trans people, especially in our political climate. And there's over 200 bills that have been put forth that are not being covered in the media that are targeting trans people in the legal system. So we have to be bold, we have to be visible, and we have to honor and highlight that UCSB is UCSB because of our trans students and faculty, because of our faculty of color, and every intersection in between. And of course, we all play this role in creating these environments. We want to support trans students in our community with equity. So I know I mentioned this in our last time we were here, but I want to do a little review. Who can tell me, and I know maybe some of you can speak to me here, I'm still figuring out if that's true, if what is the difference between equality and equity? What would be the difference between it?
Equality is treating everyone equally, where equity is treating everyone fairly.
Okay. So equality is treating everyone equally, equity is treating everyone fairly, okay? Other thoughts? Okay. So I'll give a quick example. So treating everyone equally, that's exactly right. So any student on campus can go to student health. right? No one is barred from going in. Even if you don't have health insurance, you can go in, at least talk to somebody, ask a question, make a referral. No one's barring your access. That's equality. Anyone is welcome in here. Equity is asking the question, will a transgender student feel that there is a healthcare provider that is going to be knowledgeable and inclusive of how to best support them emotionally, socially, and medically? And the answer is yes, we do have a trans healthcare specialist, and that is a form of equity, making sure that students are getting what they need to succeed, right? So that's like everyone in the room is barefoot, but you all need shoes, right? So I bring in a bunch of shoes and I give Carrie a men's size 16 Timberland boots, if that's even a size. I get a kid's ballet slipper. You know, these are things that are not giving me what I need, but you all got shoes. That's equality. So equity is getting students what they need, especially trans people have to question so often, is there going to be equity in the service that I'm going for? There was a case recently where a trans man was denied a haircut because he was not seen as fully a he. And so he couldn't even get a haircut. So it's like things that we might take for granted as just easy access for us, because of the way the conversation is going, both in support of and still in exclusion of trans people, there are all these questions of equity that come into mind. And we also want to create a celebratory and nurturing environment where trans students can thrive. Okay, so why are we here as Wealthy RCSUD? So we have a commitment that being trans is beautiful. It is diverse, it is complex, it is powerful and strong. But as I was alluding to, it is under attack in our world every day. So that's why it's the commitment of the RCSUD, of UCSB, to really make sure that we were highlighting the successes of trans people, that we are showing there is not one way to be transgender. We're gonna delve into really a deeper understanding and connection of what that means and how that can look in different students, different staff, different dynamics, how people are engaging with these topics. People are finding so much power and identity and strength in being transgender and being who they are, but we can't deny that there are people that would wish to do harm or hurt trans communities. So we're going to delve into sort of the spectrum there today. So I'm going to just ask for a call out because this is going to be a group partnership, and it's Carrie and I here. But so either in the past or present, and you can just call out, how have you felt limited by your gender? So roles that you were expected to be in for being a man or a woman, expectations on you for being a man or a woman, stereotypes, limitations. Just want to hear from maybe two people on, just name an example of a time you just felt limited, something you couldn't do because you were a boy or couldn't do because you were a girl.
This could go on for a long time.
Right?
I mean, because I work at IT, and I got to say that this is probably the first job where I haven't felt that limited. It's the first. So, I mean, you want a specific example?
Well, yeah, I mean, maybe tell me a little bit more, unpack that a little bit for me, because you said this is the first time you haven't felt limited, implying that there have been limits.
Yeah, like you can't, well, like in a meeting, like when I was pregnant and I made a comment in a meeting, someone said, well, don't pay attention to her, she's pregnant.
Right.
So therefore, I can't have any valid ideas, I guess. Hopefully after I'm not pregnant, I can, or maybe because I can get pregnant, my ideas are never valid. I don't know. I didn't know what to take that. But I mean, or what's a cute little thing like you working on a problem like that for? So those kind of comments, you know, I don't know. There's lots of them, but I don't want to go into that. But you just still, like in a technology field, you're not going to have a valid idea.
Thank you.
Someone else that wants to talk about, maybe it's from childhood, maybe it's a message you learned about something you could or could not do because of your gender.
I'll chime in just as a counterpoint to the worst I can think of is someone commenting that me taking care of my son, I was babysitting. And that wasn't a couldn't do. That was just you know, for some reason, because I'm a man, I was babysitting my own child.
Right.
That's the only thing. And I kind of echo what Anne said. I had a debate online recently about a requirement for some conference that there be at least one woman presenting for a video game conference. And they failed to even get one woman. I mean, there were lots of women that could have done it, but they sort of be forced to do it. They found one person and she dropped out, so they were stuck. They couldn't do it. In the discussion on that, I commented that I've worked in IT for 30 years, and it's rare that I haven't been in a place where I've seen the other side of what Anne's saying, where I've heard some comment, either with a woman in the room or not, that was basically the same thing. You know, like, oh, I guess, you know, women aren't naturally good at logic. How did she figure that out? Or that level of...
Yeah, and I ask this because this is really the roots of understanding the plight, or not understanding, because we can't understand, we can just relate, we could, you know, empathize, of what trans people are experiencing, as well as people who are just simply wishing to break out of a gender role, which doesn't necessarily make someone transgender, but it's very much in line with this idea of gender expansiveness, right? That we are not so limited and boxed by our gender expectations, right? And that can go into issues of employment. And this is not even talking about trans yet, right? This is just our issues are so deep rooted with gender norms. And it's because, and every society approaches differently, every culture, every time period, every religion does it differently. But if we look at our everyday society here in Santa Barbara, right, here in the US, we are reflecting scripts for us based on our sex assigned at birth, right? So if you have a penis, and we'll get into this more when we go into terminology, if you're born with a penis, not everyone will do this, but you might, you know, have a blue baby room, right? You might be given at your first birthday a football. Like, these are things that might sound like antiquated, but it's still happening. Like, I have a one-year-old nephew. You better believe when my sister found out that he was male, that room was blue, that his name was picked from the men's name list, the boy's name list in the baby book, that he was getting sports. He hasn't gotten a single Barbie. He hasn't gotten anything pink. It's still very pervasive. And we're seeing so many really strong examples of people breaking out of those roles, defying expectations just within non-transgender identities. Every person has a gender, right? Whether they have no gender, they are a man, they're a woman. And the rate at which we even think, are we limited, is a direct result of this gender construction. Because I, you know, presently, I'm a man, right? That's how I identify. I will not wear a dress. I won't wear a dress. I have no desire for it. That doesn't mean that I would have had a desire for it. It just means that the choice for me to express myself was so ingrained in me from such a young age, from the way my hair was cut, the way I was told not to cry, the way I was told to man up, the way I was told to interact with women. And that's so different between everybody, but there's commonalities and there's a systemic issue with how we are socializing people to gender. And everyone is hurting from it, especially transgender people who try to break out of it. So just talking a little bit about gender expectations. So you know what? Because it's so deep ingrained, this is what boys do, this is what girls do. And as times change, we see different variations of gender. The way that a man would look in maybe 1920s might be different than the way they look now. You go to South Africa, you go to Bangladesh, men are expressing themselves differently. So we have to really take those into account. But because of how deep ingrained it is, we don't really give a lot of thought to it. Right? So we don't really give a lot of thought to feminine behavior by people who look like women, right? And sometimes we're giving thought to it in a degrading way. Like, oh, one of you mentioned, oh, you're so cute, you know, you're figuring out this problem. Like, because I'm feminine, I can't also be brilliant in technology, because I am not a masculine presenting woman. I'm not strong because I wear makeup and have long hair and wear a dress. I'm not able to run a Fortune 500 company, right? Like, we have this big, we have this grip on our gender expectation based on how we look in our feminine and masculine behaviors. So gendered instructions for men and women. So men on one side of the room, women on the other. We see that in religion. We see that in classrooms even. Like, many of you I know have children. I can guarantee that some teacher has or will say, and maybe you have super progressive schools that talk about these topics, maybe you have heard this in your life, I need three young strapping boys to help me carry these textbooks. And you'll pick the thinnest, frailest boy and expect them to be able to do it over a girl. And then we have girls who don't expect a lot of themselves because they don't even think that they have an agency to. Gendered facilities, so men must go in here, boys must go in here. Sports teams, expectations of strength and of value. So imagine if your gender identity, however, does not conform. In your office, in your classroom, really think about how the above could impact you, right? If you're that feminine woman, right, you have these feminine characteristics, but you're biologically male. Or you all see me, I have my beard, my body size, my haircut, my voice, whatever it is. What if I wanted to wear lipstick? How would the respect I'm given change? Would the focus just be, why is this guy wearing lipstick, instead of, why am I gendering an inanimate object that is meant to change the hue of someone's skin tone for their personal expression? We focus on difference as something to be a spectacle and not on the individual value that people are placing and how they express themselves, right? So these are some of the questions that I want you all to be thinking about throughout this workshop. Is the only way to really connect is to really be grounded in, just because, you know, people don't have to be transgender to know what it's like to feel limited by your gender role or your gender norms, to feel a longing if you're a young boy to do something feminine, quote unquote, to feel a longing as a young girl to do something masculine. That doesn't make you transgender. It makes you part of the system of gender that is making it hard and difficult for countless people to just live and enjoy their life. So a couple of just really stereotypical images that kind of reinforce the expectations we have on people. And I want to ask Carrie, because she's here and she could see it on the big screen. So what would make a boy, like, what factor does a boy have to have for them to be given a football? Why is a boy given a football maybe when they're a little kid and not a girl as much? Plenty of girls are given footballs. But why are boys given, like, what is the, I'm talking crude here. I'm talking like, what? How does someone know to give a human being a football at a young age?
Probably because he has a penis.
Right, exactly. I mean, there, and the script we're following on people who have penises is these really boring things, right? Boys are football players. It doesn't make us colluding in an oppressive environment if we encourage a boy to be a football player. There's nothing wrong with that. But when we discourage girls from being football players, when we discourage boys from being cheerleaders and everything in between, that's when it becomes problematic and limiting. It's not wrong to acknowledge that male physiology is predisposed to certain amounts of muscle mass, predisposed to certain heights and weights. But when we just are focusing so much on generalizing, every male is this way, every male who's a big muscular guy has to be a football player or a wrestler, we really take away people's agency to do what they love versus what we think they should love. And if you meet a boy that loves football, encourage it. But also encourage that boy to see other boys who don't want to be football players and accept and celebrate them too. Right? Boys are pilots. Girls are stewardesses. Right? Or gay men are stewards. Right? Girls are cheerleaders. Right? And if we look on the left here, there's a painting and a photograph. Who is this person? One of the most famous people in world history. Who is this person? This painting right here and this image is Teddy Roosevelt. Okay? So Teddy Roosevelt, as a young kid, this was how gender was expressed for maybe a royal or someone who in someone who is a diplomat or someone who's wealthy or someone who, it doesn't matter. When we start to realize that gender is so constricted to so many societal factors, we can hopefully start to break out and see that Teddy Roosevelt wearing long hair, little tap shoes, a bonnet, and a dress doesn't make Teddy Roosevelt less of a boy. Doesn't make him less of a male, right? So when we talk about this idea of a binary, right, this does not include transgender people. So we think of our world, everyday people who are not connected to these topics, who just haven't gotten this education because it's not something that, you know, students and youth are really taught about. It's not really as ingrained in mainstream culture in cartoons or kids shows. It's very, or in history books. It's very much something that is, you have to really search for. And there's newer representations of trans people in the media, of course, more and more in the last couple of years. But in terms of being integrated the way that heterosexual people are, people who are not transgender are represented, it doesn't compare even for a second. So when we look at this idea of a binary, right, bi, comparing two things, two modalities, we have female, right? So if you're born female, that means you are born with certain chromosomes, you're born with a vagina, maybe. I mean, these are things that scientists decree, this is what's female. That means, in this idea of a binary, that you are automatically a woman if you have a vagina, that you're automatically feminine or should be feminine, and that you're automatically attracted to men, right? These are the types of systems that we are indoctrinating people into. A lot of times we do it and don't realize we're doing it, right? It's coming from a harmless place. You have a little girl who's 2 years old, and guess what? Maybe Carrie has a little boy who's 2 years old. And you make a little joke that says, how cute would it be if they got married? That comes from such an innocent place. That's the script that you're used to seeing. A boy and a girl, that's what they should do. But people have a freak out, and this is tapping into Safe Zone 1 a little bit. If, would Carrie ever be quick to say, if I had a 2-year-old boy and she had a 2-year-old boy, oh, wouldn't it be cute if they got married one day? That would not be as cute to some parents, right? Some parents might say, yeah, you never know. And other parents would be like, why are you saying my kid's gay? Why are you saying this? Why would you do that? You know? So this gives an example of how it comes from a harmless place, and the harm comes when all we do is expect this binary. It's not wrong to give kids that are female dresses. Where it becomes questionable is if you shame them and harm them for wanting to wear something that is outside of this binary idea. So this was from a Japanese advertisement for their gender and sexuality center in Tokyo. And I love this because no little kid is, maybe their room looks like this if they're really, you know, organized or they like spreading things out. And of course the color scheme, it's a photograph. But this is an example to highlight the culmination of messages that many kids are digesting at these extremely rapid rates, right? And there's some crossover, and a lot of times there isn't crossover. And this kind of highlights what we're doing to kids when we're being so stark in the binary, right? When we don't allow them to make their own choices, when we don't show them multiple options, when we thrust them so deeply into these binaries, right? Many kids will grow up and not even notice that they could have had another choice or not even think otherwise. You can do nature and nurture all you want, but for the little kids that are hurting because they can't cross over this line here, which is imaginary, the only thing stopping this little boy from getting this little stuffed bunny or this little hair dryer or this makeup kit and this little girl from these blocks and these engineering tools and this truck is us. We're the only thing stopping them from this imaginary line that separates what they know in their heart makes them happy through an imaginary script that we're forcing upon them based on the sex they were assigned at birth. So when we talk about trans identities and experiences, I can't say this enough. I am not transgender. So what we're going to do is we're going to show a couple minutes of, and this is, you know, bold of me to say, but I'm going to say it. This is the best video clip I have ever seen in all of my years of doing this type of work that really highlights and gets into the heart of what an experience can be, not only as someone who is transgender, but what we are doing to our kids to promote their own confidence.
I'm a mom of five. We live in Brooklyn. We just moved to Bed-Stuy. We're just like a regular family. We are always at a crossroad, like, can we afford tuition? Like, do we eat green food or do we eat like fast food? What's cheaper? So this is Othello. It's my rascal. This is Cassius, my oldest. I just call him the president.
That's Penelope.
That's Penelope, who's seven.
I'm eight.
Penel is my third child. And we assumed girl, like perfectly anatomically perfect girl. Everything looked in order. Really early on, there were signs that Penel was very different. Something was weighing on Penelope really, really heavy. Every time we would try to put him, put clothing on him or dress him or bathe him, there was like an intense reaction to his body from himself. Once Penelope started to speak, it was like, I'm not a baby. It's one of the first like sentences, I'm not baby. And no, it was like no to clothing, no to shoes, no to hairbrushing. And so one day I remember pulling Penelope aside and just being like, you know, like what's really wrong, baby? Like, why are you so upset? And Penelope said, no, because everyone thinks I'm a girl. And so I said, oh, baby, it's fine. You can, however you feel on the inside is great. And he said, no, I don't feel like a boy, Mama, I am a boy. And so like that sentence was really hard because you don't, I was like ill-equipped, like, okay, what do I do with that? I don't know how to handle that. I felt like I had kind of maybe dropped the ball in some area. All of my sisters and my mom, you know, raised me to really be proud of being a woman. And my child was like, I don't want to be a woman. Like, I'm not a woman. I don't want to be a woman. I love you, Mom, but I don't want to look like you. I want to look like Dad. So I just felt like, what had I done? Had I forgotten to do something that was really essential to self-pride?
That's my sister. That's me when I was 3 years old, when I was shy. That's me. That's Cash. That's
Penelope. A lot of people confuse this conversation that I had with Penelope as being something too advanced for like a two-year-old to talk about, but identity is something that happens that early. I think when people like say, well, how does Penelope know that he's a boy at age two? And I would say, well, when did you realize you were a woman? It was like crystal clear what he was saying. I don't want to be Mama. I want to be Papa. I want a doctor to make me a peanut. I don't want boots. I do remember at that moment in my head not considering Penelope sheep anymore. I was really aware that what Penelope was talking about was identity. But in terms of me, why did I let my kid sort of bleed in this moment? You know, because it smacked me in the face. This is going to be a finger. Yeah. It's blush.
Don't say it. Fingers of blood. Oh, you do. It's apple blood. Oh, Mom. No, don't do that. Don't use apple blood.
Ketchup.
No, Mom. I don't like ketchup stuff. You said
fingers with blood. Like after we just said, okay, yes, you're a boy and it's all good. And like, yes, you can wear really like boy clothing, not like tomboy clothing, but like just go to the boy section, like find anything that you want to wear and wear it. You know, you just kind of lit up. Initially, it's like weird. You notice like all the constructs around gender. And in the same way, you become very keen on the way you treat girls and the way you treat boys. I like the fact that the kids sometimes talk about it and debate it or don't see eye to eye. And if Penelope can handle that conversation in our house, then he's ready for handling it in the world. His siblings and his friends protecting. So like if we're walking into a new situation, a lot of times his best friends will step ahead and be like, okay, so my friend Penelope is coming. He is a boy, he likes to be seen as a boy. You can call him Penel, you can call him Penelope, you can call him Jack, but he's gonna come in and he's a boy. So there's like this kind of like camaraderie that his siblings have with him and his friends have that, you know, they kind of look out for him. I'm kind of like, ugh, like sick in my stomach when I start thinking about puberty. It's like all of the rites of passages of a woman with trans kids, those are the worst things to have. You know, like a trans boy gets his period, sometimes it can be like super depressing. Penel's body is not everything, right? It's a part of him, but it's not the whole story. And so when I think of puberty, when people start to like really focus on how Penelope's looking, it makes me nervous because in our minds, girls look this way and boys look that way. So it's going to be harder for people to understand that Penelope's boy. There's not a lot of research around things that transgender people do medically to change, to alter their bodies. There's not a ton of research around it. So that makes me nervous. I mean, I don't really like I'm super organic and our food is super clean, and the idea of like taking hormones and injecting chemicals daily is frightening. And really, Penelope's a boy without changes. He doesn't have to change. He doesn't have to take hormones or puberty blockers or change his body, have surgery. If he chooses to, he might, but he doesn't have to. He's a boy regardless.
He's the Bluosaurus.
We don't know his official name.
A lot of the things I thought I would never be able to handle, you get it together really quickly when it's your kid. I think about the future, and I try to think that everything's good, that I live in New York City, that this is 2015, and yeah, I think people's minds are changing. I think the collective understanding is that we are who we are from the inside out, and so that is kind of the direction we're moving in. We're really caring more about individuals than we do about big corporations. I love this. This makes me feel really kind of optimistic about the future. So two lessons that I've learned from my transgender child are, first one, winners or losers that got back up. Like, that's the biggest thing. You just have to keep getting back up. Everyone who's ever succeeded, anyone that's fantastically, amazingly successful, has had, like, loser moments. The best have gone through the worst. And so we have to keep getting back up. And I think the other one is, you know, accept happiness in any form. Like, who am I to say how happiness looks, you know, or how happiness feels? And it's just, on a simple level, allow for happiness in all forms.
Thank you for watching that with me. My opinion, really mom of the century. I wanna hear from the group here, what were some initial thoughts from, or some takeaways that you are gleaning from that clip? Something that struck you or stuck out to you?
I agree that mom is incredible and an amazing adapter to challenge, because I was trying to sort of put myself in the same place, and I'm not sure how I would handle like my daughter telling me that she was a boy and being incredibly challenging and sort of difficult to comprehend.
Exactly. And that is your ability to comprehend is so mitigated by the scripts that you grew up with too. So it's not something to be faulted by. I would never fault you for having a challenge with that, because we're not generally socialized to behave the way that mom is behaving with her son. One more person who something stuck out to them.
Yeah, like when she was talking about Penel going through puberty, I was just thinking like, oh wow, that's gonna be so hard for him. Like what locker room is he going to have to use? Like, is it gonna be like the scene from Carrie? Like, you know,
mm-hmm.
I really felt for him in that moment.
Yeah, and thank you. And that really highlights the need for teachers from K through 12, community leaders, SIS&T, every person to have this information so that it could be less difficult. And for me, I mean, I loved the main message, which relates to my opening slide about empathy. Who am I to say what happiness looks like? Why are we not celebrating happiness versus coming from a deficit? My daughter doesn't want to look feminine versus my son loves the way he looks. So coming from a place of happiness, coming from a place of empathy, not coming from a deficit. So I really wanted to set the stage because you're hearing from a trans affirming family. And that's really where it starts. So going into a little bit about our trans identities and experiences, it's tough because we are still very surprised when people come out as transgender, or it still makes national news when people come out as transgender. But gender variance has always occurred throughout history. On the left here is an example of someone who identifies as two-spirit, right? And someone who's two-spirit is not changing necessarily from one gender to another. By essence of the, you know, the prefix two, they're both genders. And these are people that in certain native sects of communities are can be seen as very revered. On the right, you know, we're looking at communities from South Asia that are known as Hijra. Right? Similarly, it's, you know, a form of trans identity. And throughout culture and history, if you look at Polynesian islands, you know, Samoa has a strong history of the Fafafine community. In native Hawaii, Mahu. But we have, through our evolution of rulers and borders and colonialism and religion, have forgotten these very rich histories of trans inclusion. This is where we started. We started loving and honoring trans and gender variant people, and we've lost a lot of that. In Bangladesh, Nepal, Pakistan, India, and Germany, they offer a third gender option, right? Which is showing that example of remembering our history of inclusion, not letting the past erasure of trans people and this script that we're following that if you're born female, you can't look like Penelope. And allowing for more variance, allowing, and that variance allows for safety. If you're allowed to denote your gender identity on the forms of the CDC, UCSB's demographic data, we can better serve communities that are often very much at risk for violence. Was there a question?
Do you hear what that third gender option is?
Yeah, so it's based on the country. So in Bangladesh, Nepal, Pakistan, and India, it's it's male, female, and hijra. So it's a third gender marker. And then in this picture, this is from Berlin Pride 2 years ago, the man with the rainbow face, that is for someone who identifies as intersex. So intersex is someone who is born with more than one genitalia, or a non-binary combination of male and female genitalia. And the statistics are between 1 in 300 to 400 are born intersex, but the amount of people that ever know that they were born intersex in the United States is very, very, very small, because doctors are parents and guardians are legally allowed to change the sex. So if you have two pronounced genitalia, the parents can decide which genitalia they should keep. Where in Germany, they pass legislation that says parents aren't actually able to do that at birth anymore. So they have to wait for the kid to grow up a little bit to kind of gauge their understanding of their gender and their sex.
So is the German one open to transgender, which is just straight XX or XY chromosomes, no ambiguity about biology?
I'm actually, where I pulled this from was just about intersex. I actually don't know where they stand on gender confirmation surgeries and trans people. But I just know that it's Germany is the only country that is discussing intersex people in this way at this moment. So that's a pretty unique thing I wanted to share. We talked about a little bit of this, but I just wanted to really kind of just revisit a little bit of 101 terminology. I know we're in 102, so we're focusing more on gender. But we talked about sex. That's just as a common review for those that maybe weren't at 101 or you know, it was a bit ago. Sex is what we're assigned at birth. We've mentioned male, female, or intersex. Gender identity expression. I really want to make sure that we have a clear understanding of what the difference between those two things are. when you talk about gender identity, right? That's what I love that Penelope's mom said. I realized that it wasn't just clothing choices. This was identity. Identity, I can describe it as how you feel in your heart and in your mind. Each one of you that's hanging out with me in this digital way right now, I don't know how you feel in your heart and your mind, how you know you are a man, how you are sure you are a woman, or vice versa. We don't make people who are born male and identify as men prove that to us, right? I'm looking at Carrie. I know Carrie, she identifies as a woman. I'm never gonna ask her to prove it to me. Prove to me that your identity is really a woman. Show me that you feel this way, right? Because her expression, I'm looking at Carrie and she's wearing a beautiful top. She has her, you know, her hair, which is maybe shoulder length or longer, up in a nice bun. She's wearing beautiful jewelry, very feminine. Is that what makes people men or women, how we dress? It's so much more than that. But that's what we often base someone's identity on. I love how Penelope's mom also said, and she should be the one in charge of these workshops, right? She said, we need to start showing people's beauty coming from the inside and then out. I know it's like a golden rule. You're beautiful on the inside as well as the outside, but especially when something as complex as identity, that we don't make people who are not transgender prove to us, right? We have to really see and believe people when they tell us how they feel, right? So gender identity is how you feel in your heart and in your mind, and your expression is what you show to the world, right? So I mentioned before the example of me wearing lipstick. If I wear lipstick, that doesn't mean I'm a woman. That's not my gender identity. That's my gender expression, right? If I wear nail polish, but I still have my facial feature, if I still look the way I'm dressed right now, that's my expression. That doesn't mean I'm any less of a man, right? So the identity is the internal, the expression is the external. And if we look at our little pictogram over here, gender is really a spectrum. A lot of people will say there's only two genders and two ways to express gender. People should look like this and not like this if they're born with a penis or vagina or chromosomes and vice versa. We went into that. It's a range of expression. Tomorrow I could wear makeup. The next day I could wear camos and go paintballing. Like, neither one of those things are what make me a man, right? Those are things that I'm just doing, right? We have stereotypes and scripts that reinforce that men are more likely to do this or that and vice versa. How you relate to yourself, and I can't stress this point enough as a takeaway of today, one of the few, it's how you relate to yourself. Your gender is not your sexual orientation, right? And I reinforce that not because I think you all don't know that, or maybe it's a good refresher, but a lot of people in your lives and in your communities that you are now tasked to be influencing with this training, right? That's the goal. It's not just that you keep this insular to SIS&T, that wherever you go, when you see these gender inequities and these limits that we're putting on people, that hopefully you can feel confident to speak out against it or to offer a reframing, right? Personal identity, not your defined by chromosomes. Now, just a quick refresher, cisgender, if we look at the root, right? So there's a matching or a sameness there. So cisgender was only recently added to the Oxford English Dictionary. It's okay if you say, I haven't heard of that. Is that a made up word? Technically all words are made up. So here's another one for you. If that's in the dictionary currently, it's a new addition. Cisgender means that something aligns, right, in your gender and your sex. So I see Joe Sabato here. He was born male. As he grew up, I'm guessing he felt like a boy, and today he identifies as a man. And when I look at him, I automatically think glasses, haircut, shirt, clothing, body language, he's a man. It matches. The goal is not that we have to match. That's just the expectation that we match. It's okay to not match your sex assigned at birth with your gender identity or expression. That's where we get into transgender, right? Something isn't matching up. Your sex assigned at birth is not matching either your gender identity or your expression, right? If I say to Carrie, Carrie, look, I'm dressing the way that many men would dress given our culture, our time period, our, you know, you would look at me, Carrie, and you would say, yes, Dave's a man, but just by the way he looks. But if I say to you, Carrie, I really feel like a woman, I shouldn't have to change my expression and start wearing dresses, because not all women wear dresses. Not all women have long hair. Not all women are feminine and are born female. So it's the same thing. I shouldn't have to prove it to you through how I look for you to believe how I feel. That's an ideal. It's not always the case. Sexual identity and behavior is not your gender identity or expression. You can be a feminine boy and be heterosexual. You can be a masculine woman and be heterosexual. You can be a masculine man, quote unquote, and be gay or bisexual. That does not have a bearing on your gender. However, how we are socializing people to read gender is what people are basing someone's perceived sexual orientation, right? So for example, I'm looking at you, Joe. Here we are again. My script, and I have unlearned many of those things in the nature of my work. I don't look at people and assess or judge how they look with what their sexual orientation is. But guess what? I'm a product of my own environment. I suspend judgments. I suspend my disbelief. But if I look at Joe Sabato, I think I'm looking at a straight guy. What he's wearing, how he's sitting, how he's acting. His gender expression should not be the hear-all, end-all of what I think his sexual orientation is. There are stereotypes that fit in with what straight men look like, with what gay women look like, with what bisexual people look like. It doesn't mean they're all untrue. It just means they're incomplete, right? And we want to allow people to have the variance and not cast every Joe Sabato-looking person as a straight guy, because we're limiting ourselves and the people around us, okay? Couple of words that are really rising in prominence, especially in youth. So gender expansive and gender queer, those are two words that are synonymous, right? So I would be gender expansive if I'm wearing this outfit, but I'm wearing a really nice, like frilly, flowery, like sun hat that you might just see on a woman or someone without a beard, right? That's me being gender expansive. It's just switching it up. Like if Rich Wilson, my buddy, walks into work tomorrow, well, remotely, but puts on a suit and wears stilettos, right? It would look odd to most people. That's being gender queer or gender expansive. You are changing things up, combining traditional elements of femininity, masculinity, androgyny all together. Similar with gender nonconforming. Some people, however, will identify as genderqueer or gender nonconforming. They'll say, I am not transgender. I'm also not a boy. I'm also not a girl. I'm a person that has certain body parts, but my gender is not limited by man or woman or even trans man or trans woman. That's where you have gender nonconforming, gender queer, gender expansive. It allows people, because even if we have someone like, I know everybody knows Caitlyn Jenner. Everyone knows who that is. That's sort of working in its own way. Caitlyn Jenner worked to get into the mainstream dialogue. But Caitlyn Jenner, right, is very gender conforming, right? So she is a trans woman who wears beautiful gowns, has gorgeous long hair, makeup, right? She in herself is gender conforming. So how are you as a young kid who wants to have a beard and wear lipstick? Where's your role model, right? So this is where we have to always give credence to people that are coming out of the binary, because even though Caitlyn Jenner is trans, she's still fitting into a binary. This is what many women hope to or do look like, right? But she just shouldn't have, like I said before, she shouldn't have to look like that to be viewed as a woman. And this just gives another spectrum that everything is a spectrum. So you're assigned sex, your gender identity and your expression are all on a spectrum. There are plenty of times, like I think of the example of, you know, how we find dad so cute, or maybe the other example where you gave that, oh, you're babysitting, you're at work or something. We find it so quote unquote cute, oh, a dad holding a baby. Like, because men are not as socialized to be seen as caretakers, as loving people as much as they should be, right? So we sort of like make these novelties, right? But there's so much more gender expression in terms of variance from on this spectrum. A couple of quick notes about language. So queer and trans. So we talked in 101 about the word queer, a term that incorporates both gender, sexual orientation, a political ideology towards being more liberal and open. And some people use queer, some people don't. Some people think it's harmful, some people have reclaimed it. Trans, however, you might notice in some of our programming that we don't always just say the word queer, because many trans people don't feel included in the LGBTQ community. So we did a luncheon, an empowerment panel with the Department of Engineering and the MLPS department, and it was queer and trans women in STEM. Because there's so much more erasure of trans people than there are of LGBTQ people, that we always want to make sure we're pointedly saying we include trans people. So if ever you're using the word queer, I would also couple it with the word trans. Right? It gives you a way to really show that you get that trans people aren't always included and you want to include them. Talk a lot about pronouns. I'm going to save pronouns because we have a little bit longer slide on that. Transgendered, tranny, she-male, he-she, these are very triggering terms that people often hear a lot. Transgendered, the grammar there implies that something was done to somebody, that it wasn't something they've always felt. It's like, oh, Carrie went to the Lilith Fair concert, she got lesbianed, you know? Like, that is not gonna make Carrie a lesbian. Carrie identifying however she identifies is what is gonna make her identify that way, nothing else, right? So that's the same for trans people. People say, oh, you were molested as a child, so that's why you're trans. Or you hate men, that's why you're trans. Like, you got transgendered. It comes from a really innocent place. Like, people say, oh, there's a lot of transgendered people here. That's okay. You would just reframe it and say, oh, actually, the way to express it is there are a lot of trans people here, transgender people here. Someone is transitioning would be the verb, or they've transitioned, right? Gender confirmation, affirmation, and transition are three ways that you can be really welcoming of people's journey through anything medical. The number one rule is to never focus a conversation on trans identity around someone's physical medical transition. It makes people feel very commodified. It makes people feel under a microscope. We wouldn't talk about the biology. I wouldn't ask Carrie if she had surgery if she told me she was a woman, right? But if she tells me she's a trans woman, I might say, oh, are those your real breasts? Do you still have a penis? Right? That's very, it's a double standard and it's undermining. So here's a couple of examples of trans women. So just as a reminder, like assigned male at birth, but identify as women. Some of them have had surgeries, both top surgery, bottom surgery, some have not. We have one of the Wachowski sisters now. They both came out as transgender. It's kind of a unique case. Carmen Carrera, a famous model. Laverne Cox, who's an activist and actress from Orange is the New Black. And Gina Rosero, who we're going to actually conclude with a clip from today, who's a Filipina model and activist who came out as trans 2 years ago in a famous TED Talk. Trans men, right? A lot of trans men are very much, especially trans men and trans women who transition, note a lot of privilege changes, right? So Shane Ortega, who's right here, here's the first openly trans active military service member. He was at UCSB this year in the fall with our Veteran Military Services Office. And he said when he transitioned physically, he noticed he was treated so differently. When Carmen Carrera, when she transitioned, she noticed she was called those pet names, she was undermined, she was devalued, and the privilege really does change. And we really get to see some of that in the stories of trans people. Here's where we talk about some of those identities. Like on the right here, we have Ruby Rose. She's a DJ, an actress. She identifies as gender fluid, right? So she might have a short haircut, but wear makeup, right? What a concept. But she still uses she and her pronouns, right? Angel Hayes, who's a really prominent rapper, might look very much like a woman, long hair, maybe backwards hat, a little more masculine, whatever. But Angel Hayes, I even said she. So even I make mistakes, but you correct yourself. Uses pronouns they and them, right? So those are pronouns that people use. No one is asking you when they say they and them for you to call them like, hey, Luke Skywalker, or hey, moron. Like, they're asking you to use they and them, and if you really want to get nerdy and technical, which this might be my audience, these might be my people who love to do that like I do, if you look in the 16th century, the first utterance or use of they and them in the Oxford English Dictionary was singular they. And we use they all the time. You know, it's their book, it's their this, it's their that. And it's really a reframing of what matters. Is it so hard for me to adapt to a new syntax or to a new way to relearn how to use they? Or is it just I don't want to because I don't really care enough to support a student feeling like they can be themselves? Here's a great example of gender expression, gender variance. Eddie Izzard, right? Very famous comedian. I'm not confused about my gender. I'm a bloke in a dress. And people would say, how do you feel about wearing women's dresses? He goes, well, it's not a woman's dress. It's my dress, you know? And there are plenty of people who feel that, you know, drag is insulting or satirical. But, you know, no, Eddie Izzard is not putting on a caricature of a woman. He's a man who's wearing clothing that is deemed only for women. That's not a caricature. He's saying, I'm wearing a dress. That should not mean I'm a woman, right? And his pronouns are he and him. Rachel Maddow, there's a before and I guess after. Rachel Maddow is not confused about her gender because she wears men's clothing. She is very certain that she is a woman. So we're delving into a little bit more about how these are trickling into our daily lives, right? So here at UCSB. So 47% of genderqueer and transgender respondents to the campus climate survey reported experience of exclusionary behavior. That is a very high number, no matter how many people took it. 35% did not feel that their gender identity is respected here, despite the efforts of the RCSGD, despite the efforts of our campus partners. 5% of men felt this way and 7% of women. Unfortunately, 34 and 38% of folks found the campus climate to not be comfortable, right? And people are perceiving a lot of tensions. Now, whenever people see visibility, right? Two things happen. Visibility equals violence, right? There's all this visibility of trans people like Caitlyn Jenner, Laverne Cox, and people are being targeted for being trans because they don't like that there's all this visibility. It's a causality that we see with our black president, how much more anti-blackness came about. There's a direct causality that we can't ignore. Second thing is a lot of support. People really see this visibility and they say, wow, this is amazing. Like, I want to change my heart and mind, or I want to move forward and support people. There's a third thing that happens when we have visibility, though. We leave people out. So you see that Caitlyn Jenner is there, you think, ah, we're good. Trans people are safe here. They have Caitlyn Jenner. They have Laverne Cox, right? And we forget that this is a 28,000 more or less person campus, and we don't know everybody. So even when you see things from the RCSGD, be proud of the RCSGD, be proud of yourselves for being in this workshop, but don't rest on the fact that because we're doing stuff, that that means everybody is proportionately impacted positively. Because there's so many people that we're not reaching when we don't have partners like you all, like other areas of campus life, to be spreading that message with us. It can't just be just us, because then people rest on the fact they're handling it, we don't have to do anything. When there's too many people here to rest on that. Things happening on college campuses, so restrooms and changing rooms. Someone mentioned that when Penelope goes to school, where are they gonna go? High schools are very messy with this. There's no common standard, whereas in sports teams, NCAA regulation says that you have to respect a student's gender identity. And they play on the team, and there's some regulations with hormone therapy and things like that. They play on the team, that's on their gender. Pronouns, some schools are asking for pronouns. UCSB is not doing that, but it might in the future. UCSB is allowing for preferred name. I know you all have been buzzing about that. Maybe many of you working on that. That's now live thanks to the efforts of you, your peers, everyone in the technology world that made this a reality. Records, ID cards, and forms will be updated with a preferred name. Housing options, we offer a really great program for students in the Rainbow House. We offer a great program for students that are wanting to choose a trans roommate or a gender nonconforming roommate. We do private selection for that. We're seeing a lot more students identify, as I mentioned, as non-binary, gender nonconforming. coming out younger, right? We're seeing that as well too. I'm seeing a lot more UCSB students showing up already transitioned or showing up already out about being trans, and some that are still very much in the closet and dealing with support from families, mental health. Informed parents, friends, and family, this is where you all come in, as many of you are parents, have spouses, have significant others, have grandparents. It spreads. So the more that you can impart what you know and what you've learned, the more that youth intersectionally, intergenerationally, cannot have to struggle in a way that we already fear Penelope might. So this is where maybe you all come in, because there can be some sweeping, I don't know, algorithm that goes in that finds every UCSB form that asks people male or female only. I work with student health. We've updated their forms. It doesn't just say male or female. Name changes for diplomas, your benefits still need to be legally changed, whereas the class rosters doesn't need a legal name change. Okay. So campus facilities, you know, we allow this at UCSB, and we're changing all of our single stall restrooms to make sure that they have a gender inclusive restroom sign. It's not just women who are changing babies. You know, restrooms that are single stall do not need to be gendered. And many people who worry, oh, you know, trans people are going to violate me in a bathroom. There is not a single documented case in U.S. history of a trans person attacking someone in a bathroom, but there are hundreds of cases of trans people being attacked in bathrooms. Talking a little bit about athletics, people get a bit dicey about that. But research is showing, and the Olympics have included this in their discussions. Post-surgical trans folks have a psychological profile comparable to individuals of that birth sex. There's all this fear of someone's going to compete, and the Olympics is still using the term transsexual, but they're looking to change that. Cross-dressing, peepers, or locker room gender policing. These are the sort of language that people are using to cause hysteria. Healthcare, we talked about that at UCSB. All of our insurance is covering trans students. These are great things to promote. Housing. In all but 17 states, trans people can be denied housing. Climate and attitudes of housemates and roommates and neighborhood. These are things that trans people have to think about before they live anywhere. Your name on your credit report, if you weren't able to change it, or your gender presentation. Even going into shelters, there's highest rates of sexual assault, harassment, and denial of access if you're trans and people find out, or if they discover it, they can remove you, or if you're gender nonconforming and you haven't fully transitioned and you're not passable yet. In careers, trans people from hiring and promotion, name associated with your degree might be different than your current name. References might not check out. When can you be out at work? But we're seeing that 78% of people studied in a national survey of Out and Equal, which is the only LGBTQ organization dedicated to human resources professionals, that people feel more comfortable at work post-transition. What a world. At a glance, to wrap up our issue section, family and home life at UCSB continues to be a concern for our students. I still meet with students whose parents don't accept them, that they won't, you know, claim them as their pronouns that they're using. I had a student that said that their mom tried to shave their head when they grew their hair out. Like, I hear it all. So visibility and mentorship, right? We really try to connect students here with our mentoring program. And, you know, we want to make sure that people feel like they have visible role models for them, and we connect students to visible role models. Transgender people are 4 times more likely than the population to live in extreme poverty, making less than $10,000 a year, and often are forced into sex work, which can be dangerous. That's still a profession, whether it's legal or not. People are doing that, and there's no shame in it, but a lot of times people feel forced into doing it or are trafficked into doing it. Unfortunately, 80% of trans people experience harassment when they're young, and even as adults, just things that we take for granted, sitting on a train, going to a store, into a restaurant, especially with all these bills, and people are even denying people making cakes, you know? So, and that's for same-sex couples who are both gender-conforming. Unfortunately, 41% of trans people attempt suicide, and 18 states have clear law, only 18 have clear laws that protect trans people. You might think, and I hope you do, what world are we living in? That only 18 states are protecting clearly trans people. If it wasn't for President Obama, federal employees would not have any protections for gender and sexuality, but at least if you're a federal employee, you can be protected. Yep.
Really quick, you went kind of quickly over that. Did you say 41% of all trans people attempt suicide at some point in their life? Half, basically?
Yep, and that's a result from the Trevor Project, which is the only LGBTQ crisis, 24/7 crisis hotline in the world. And that is the number of people that attempt. 41% attempt.
That's an incredible number.
Yeah. Talked about this. Okay, I want to focus a little bit on intersectionality here as we get into our last 20 minutes. We have to be rooted in the fact that trans women of color have a national life expectancy of 35. If you are a trans woman of color, the surveys from Trevor Project, Human Rights Campaign, that your life expectancy is 35 years old. And we have seen in 2015 alone that 23 trans women of color have been murdered due to gender-based violence. People are being mutilated. There are letters written. There are, hair removed. There's all these terrible ways that people are discovering that this was gender-based violence. None of it was through a car crash. None of it was through any of those things. These were all bodies that were found in places that were horribly mutilated. Many people were misgendered. There's a lack of reporting. We don't really see this on Facebook trending unless you're following it. So I encourage you, if you don't follow the Transgender Law Center on Facebook, just give them a like. Transgender Law Center, Trans Equality Now. These are two great sites that you can just stay informed, right? We have folks like Cece McDonald, trans woman of color, who's fighting against trans women in prisons. Jenny Secoutier is fighting for trans women of color in detention. Laverne Cox, Janet Mock, lots of people are doing good work, but it can't just be on the community to do it. I'm kind of skipping a little bit, so now we're in our final section here for the time that we have left. So an ally isn't something you are, it's something that you do. This was from our 101 that I carry into our 102. So just by learning about some of these issues, it doesn't erase the responsibility for all of us to be speaking out against these topics when we hear transphobic things, especially in this upcoming election where trans people are really not being considered or valued from certain oppositions. And you have to pair it with action. That action could be liking something on Facebook or sharing an article. You know, like Rich sends me articles all the time. Like, those are great examples of showing your support. So thank you, Rich. It could be bringing up these topics as an annual discussion. How are we moving forward forms and policies and SIS&T to help out the campus catch up with, we just have so many forms that still say male, female. That's not someone's gender, that's their sex assigned at birth, and that's also not complete. So I'm gonna unfortunately have to skip some of these great things. These are all successes from the Transgender Law Center of ways that people were, here's one, you know, Christina Lopez and Nicole Hernandez, they were released from the abuse and detention from the Transgender Law Center that got them out of a very violent place for a trans woman of color, which is an ICE detention center. So these are lots of successes that we're seeing, and we have to be rooted in the issues, but also move forward with these successes. And you can't learn about these things because they're not always in the mainstream media. You have to educate yourselves. So pronouns, just to kind of wrap up here, asking someone's pronoun is one of the most basic ways to show respect. You can do that by simply saying, hey, I would like someone to share their pronouns. People are actually going away from the word preferred because Carrie, her pronouns are she. I don't know that that's her preferred pronoun. That just is her pronoun. It's she. So some people use multiple pronouns, and that they might say, well, today my preferred one is he. But at the end of the day, if you just use the word pronoun, you really are catching everybody, right? To not have to worry about your pronoun or how people perceive you is really something that's a privilege. And it's okay to have privilege, it's what you do with it, right? So not referring to people as it or he, she, these are offensive slurs. This is for forms and data that we're seeing on the UC application, right? So a much more expansive way that people are showing action. There's a lot of things, there's a spectrum. You can feel bad, but not really do much. You can be compliant in things, and kind of your silence is acceptance. Empathy, like we talked about, injustice. You're all at different levels, and you're only going to be able to move through those levels, giving yourself credit and time to engage on a spectrum yourselves. So, you know, you want to treat people with respect. If you make a mistake, that's okay. It's more likely to do in the beginning. Like I did with Angel Hayes, like I just corrected myself, right? I said she, and I was like, wait, they, you know, like I'm not perfect. Don't take offense if people are correcting you either. You don't have to prove that you're trans affirming by arguing with somebody like, oh, no, but you don't understand. I did this. That's not what anyone needs to hear. Like if someone is nicely saying to you, like if Carrie calls me he, I'm like, oh, Carrie, I'm actually going by she. Oh, well, that's not what I meant. I thought this, I thought that. Just say, okay. Say sorry. It's all right. We talked about a lot of these things. I really want to get to our closing clip. You want to ask thoughtful questions, but know that it's on you to really work with trans people to hear their stories, but also know that it's not their responsibility to teach you what trans means. Starting dialogues with peers, attend events and trainings like you are today. No one's perfect. We don't want to shame people in our communities. I like to look at it as reframing. So if you have a really transphobic family member, you could easily reframe that by saying, you know, I don't care if you have this, if this, it's 5 years from now. You can say, oh, well, actually, I went to a workshop recently and I actually learned that trans people are at this really high risk of suicide. I know that you have these very strict gender norms that you abide by, but is that worth someone like wanting to hurt themselves? You know, you can reframe it, you know, give them a little piece of info and not always assume that they're coming from a bad place, but still hold them accountable for the harm they might be doing with their language. You can use an I statement. I really feel that trans people deserve support. I don't have all the answers. That's what I do with immigration. Like my family and friends can sometimes say really anti-immigrant and like, you know, xenophobic things. I say, look, I know at the end of the day, I don't have all the answers, but I do know that many people are fleeing from dangerous environments. And if that was your family, you would want the ability to live freely. So look, I don't know everything there is to know about trans, but I know that if you did not feel that your gender matched your sex assigned at birth, you would want someone to care about you. Like, this isn't an agenda. This, like, is you being a woman an agenda? It's you being existing. I mean, there's feminism and important agendas that women need to have in order for equality to continue and equity to continue, but really getting to the root of why people disagree is important. These are case studies that I could send out. I'll send out the PowerPoint. I'll send out the handouts as well and do fully digital. Jeff mentioned that number is extremely high, 41%. But the same survey also indicated that one supportive person can decrease the risk of suicide among LGBT community members by 30%. And that does not all look the same way, right? So in your handouts that you'll get digitally sometime next week, you're going to get amazing tips and insights on tangible things you can be doing. But really just knowing that sometimes following those things on Facebook, speaking out against transphobia in thoughtful, accountable ways, really bringing up these topics and asking yourself, over the course of my career, what can I be contributing to trans people? And it starts by asking what the needs are, but also finding creative ways to use your influence and your roles to bring more visibility to it. So a lot of resources in Santa Barbara, our center, of course, Pacific Pride, Trans Youth, Santa Barbara Trans Advocacy Network, PFLAG. We have both campus and off-campus resources, and you're going to get the full listing of our very specific campus resources. I mentioned medical things. I mentioned the registrar. That will be in your packets, too. These are places that you can be following all on Facebook or even just the, like looking at their websites that you will also get that really will keep you informed. I want to conclude here, and then if folks have some questions, I want to conclude here with a really powerful clip from Gina Rosero. And we're only going to do 3 minutes of it because we're at the end here. And Gina is, like I said, a trans Filipina model who came out in a TED Talk as trans. And here's why she did that, because no one knew she was trans, not even her agent. And this is why she did it.
To have a surgery before you could change your name and gender marker. So in 2001, I moved to San Francisco. And I remember looking at my California driver's license with the name Gina and gender marker F. That was a powerful moment. I mean, For some people, their ID is their license to drive or even to get a drink. But for me, that was my license to live, to feel dignified. I mean, all of a sudden, my fears were minimized. I felt that I could conquer my dream and move to New York and be a model. Many are not so fortunate. I think of this woman named Ilan Nettles. She's from New York. She's a young woman who, courageously living her truth, but hatred ended her life. For most of my community, this is the reality in which we live. Our suicide rate is 9 times higher than that of a general population. Every November 20th, we have a global vigil for Transgender Day of Remembrance. I mean, I'm here at this stage because it's a long history of people who fought and stood up for injustice. This is Marsha P. Johnson and Sylvia Rivera. Today, this very moment is my real coming out. I could no longer live my truth for and by myself. I want to do my best to help others live their truth without shame and terror. I am here, exposed, so that one day there will never be a need for November 20th vigil. My deepest truth allowed me to accept who I am. Will you? Thank you very much.
Gina, one quick question for you. I'm wondering what you would say, especially to parents, but in a more broad way, to friends, to family, to anyone who finds themselves encountering a child or a person who is struggling with and uncomfortable with the gender that's being assigned them. What might you say to the family members of that person to help them become good and caring and kind family members to them?
Well, first, really, I'm so blessed. I mean, the support system with my mom, especially, my family, that in itself is just so powerful. I mean, I remember every time I would coach young trans women, you know, would mentor them, and sometimes when they would call me and tell me that their parents can't accept it, I would pick up that phone call and tell my mom, "Mom, can you call this woman?" And like, sometimes it works, sometimes it doesn't. So, but it's this gender identity is in the core of our being, right? I mean, we're all assigned gender at birth, so what I'm trying to do is to have this conversation that sometimes that gender assignment doesn't match. And there should be a space that would allow people to self-identify. And that's a conversation that we should have with parents, with colleagues. And the transgender movement, it's at the very beginning to compare to how the gay movement started. There's still a lot of work that needs to be done. There should be an understanding, there should be a space of curiosity and asking questions, and I hope all of you guys will be my allies.
Thank you, that was so lovely.
Thank you.
So I absolutely love Gina. Gina was here as well. We have these lot of pride moments with guests that we've had. Gina was here during the spring quarter, so a year ago. And she came and just is so gracious and so loving. She has an organization called Gender Proud. That's the logo there. And Gender Proud works with trans people all throughout Asia, mostly the Philippines and Thailand and other countries where the narratives of trans people, especially trans women, are being very stifled. And Gina works with lobbyists, local government officials, and I believe the Philippines recently elected one of their first senators as a transgender woman. So we're seeing a lot of really amazing activism and work out there from people that we might not even knew existed, but are the reason why so many people are finding confidence and success in their lives from mentors and visible role models like Gina. So I wanted to just ask, I know we only watched a couple minutes of Gina, but what stuck out to you from what Gina had to say? Or just something you admire about her or a little bit of her, what she shared? Or why might someone who is a fashion model on the cover of so many magazines throughout the world, runway model for all these top designers, if you look at this picture of her, you don't look at her and think, maybe you do, but you don't look at her and think, maybe she's transgender, right? You look at her and you think, this is a world-renowned model. Why would someone who has all the privilege in the world to live their life as their authentic self without being questioned, without being, you know, poked or prodded, give all that up? Why would she give it up?
I think it's, this is Carrie. I think it's that she uses her, she recognizes that she has got a privilege with her position, or that her position as model or being so public can afford her a certain privilege, and that she chooses to use her privilege to make it better, make it easier for other folks to either understand or be empathetic, or, you know, possibly start to have conversations that they might not have been able to see themselves having before.
Yeah. And it makes us wonder if Gina can give up all of her safety and all of her anonymity to do good for her community, what does it take for us who are not transgender to come out about being trans supportive? We no longer lose our safety. I mean, people might get mad at us, people might this and that. There's backlash for saying that you're supportive of something, but she gave up everything in her life, and she could have lost her modeling career, she could have lost everything. And she did it for her community, so we can certainly do our part to support people like Gina and people who don't have a platform like Gina, who don't have the ability to be a glamorous model like Gina or like Caitlyn Jenner, and really show that, you know, we can create affirming environments too. So I wanted to pause there and see if I realized that this was actually till 3:30, so I did skip a couple things. So I wanted to just first start by asking folks kind of two questions, you know, maybe one thing that you're taking away, and not everyone has to answer, of course, so it could be you answer one or the other, but I would like everyone to participate at least somewhat. One thing you're taking away from this discussion or this lecture, and one thing that you still want me to answer, you need me to clarify. So maybe we'll start with a clarifier. What are some questions that are still on your mind? If you really are feeling like you need a next step that I haven't been able to provide, or that you can't wait for the handout, what's something you need me to revisit?
Dave, this is Jeff. One thing that we haven't really gone through too much on my team, but we've sort of talked about in a very sort of outside perspective, is the idea of on almost all of our websites, we have like the gender dropdown, the male, female gender dropdown. Mm-hmm. And what that dropdown should really be, you know, in the modern environment these days, like does male and female really cut it anymore? And I'd be curious what you would suggest. Yeah, okay, I saw that page and I was wondering if that was your suggestion as far as what we should have.
Yeah, so that's a really great question, very thoughtful question. So it depends what we're using the information for, right? So if we're trying to get demographic information and we're just focused on people's sex, right? We have to ask ourselves, why are we wanting sex-based information, right? And there's reasons for that. I know there are. So especially medically, especially, you know, different things like that. But if we're just simply collecting demographic information to have it, to point to whatever it is our desired outcome is, that's when we would really need to add in the, at least, I can't cover it with my hand here, but at least this gender category. Because you can ask sex, but if you ask sex as man-woman, you're not asking about sex, you're asking about gender. Right? So you would ask, there's three sexes that are, you know, sort of agreed upon in these both, you know, social justice activism communities and medical communities, which are male, female, and intersex. So if you're asking for someone's sex assigned at birth, you'd have to say that, sex assigned at birth. And then you would say gender. And here are all the different ways that you can write in gender. Man, not male, because male is not a gender. Male is your sex. Woman, not female, because female is your sex. For example, like, I want to ask some of you on the mic here, how can this statement be true? A man can be pregnant. Explain this to me. Someone in the audience. How can a man be pregnant?
Like a transgendered male who is biologically female, or yeah, transgendered man who's biologically female can get pregnant biologically.
Exactly. So we wouldn't say transgendered, right? We would say a trans or transgender man who, exactly right, is biologically female, right? So they might have had certain surgery on the top surgery, or they might have not, but trans men that have not had certain surgeries for bottom surgery can and are pregnant. That's exactly right. So we offer this variance here on gender. Now, UCSB is asking in their UC application, they break down transgender into trans man and trans woman. But you can write that someone is transgender, but I think it's good to include trans man and trans woman. You can write in genderqueer, and then the catch-all is never other, it's fill in the blank, right? That way you're not making, most people won't blank when they write other, but some people might say, well, oh great, I'm an other, you know? I'm the last one to be picked. So fill in the blank. And then, you know, if you wanna ask sexual orientation, you can too. Does that help a little bit, Jeff? Jeff? I'm on mute?
No, we're waiting for Jeff to unmute. Probably.
So,
I was going to kind of follow with Jeff. I don't think there's that many websites where we ask gender myself, unless I'm missing something. I just looked at a couple during this talk, and we don't. So.
That's good. Maybe we could start. Other questions out there, things that I could revisit, things that you want me to review again that might have been needing some more time. Okay. I think because I have a little more time, I'm actually going to go back and review a couple of case studies that I skipped. So this can kind of contextualize for you all how these topics are kind of, you know, because they're sometimes big in the cloud, right? Like all these statistics, and the statistics are important to learn, but it's really the daily human experiences that people are having that I want to make sure that you're come away with. So when an advisor in his department transitioned from male to female, department chair Roberts heard from his MSO that students and some staff were uncomfortable with the idea of Sonia using the women's restroom. When pressed for more details, it became clear that the discomfort was primarily coming from staff members, okay? So this could be any of you at any time that's in a management role. So some suggestions, you wanna meet with the staff to hear their concerns, right? You wanna determine what other restrooms these staff members might use, because it shouldn't be the person who is trans that should have to change bathrooms. If you are having an issue from transphobia or for just discomfort or religious reasons, I don't know what you would cite, I think you should be the one to use a different restroom then. Like, this person is not doing anything harmful. The period of discomfort can sometimes last a short time, but some people, it will last forever, and they might quit or they might complain, and you have to be prepared for that. Number two, so Steve has approached his supervisor about what he considers a hostile climate being created by one of his coworkers. Steve transitioned from female to male in the workplace about 6 months ago. During the first few months after the transition, many of Steve's coworkers mistakenly referred to Steve by his former name and by the pronoun she. But in the last month, few have made any error, except Jane. Steve reports that Jane has never seemed to try to refer to him as Steve, and when corrected, seems to wave it off with a, oh yeah, that's right, in a tone that sounds a bit dismissive. Jane has asked what Steve considers inappropriate questions, such as, will your voice ever sound like a real man? When in the break room, Jane often finds a way to work in the conversation with others, but loud enough for Steve to hear something Jane has seen on TV or read on the internet that compares gender differences. Friends of Steve in the office have told him that Jane has sometimes referred to Steve as she. So these are real stories. I didn't make this up, right? Like, these are real stories of things that have happened. So you know, you want to get Jane's perspective. You need to ask Jane to use Steve's correct name and pronoun. Be direct as the supervisor or the peer. You know, you don't have to be a supervisor to talk with your peers. Refrain from asking questions of her coworkers about their medical situation, right? Never refer to any coworker as she, he, or it. We talked about that. Case number three. Jennifer has recently transitioned from male to female. She is competent and well-liked by her coworkers. Now notice, we did not say Joe, right? Jennifer, who used to be known as Joe, right? We didn't say Jennifer, who used to be known as he, right? We use the pronouns, even in past tense, that the people are using now, right? So Jennifer, not Jennifer formerly known as Joe, not Jennifer who we used to call he, transition. She is competent and well-liked by her coworkers, and for the most part, the transition has gone well. However, folks in the office have begun to gossip about the style of dress Jennifer has chosen for her new identity. One coworker has remarked that her outfits seem a bit inappropriate for the office, and one male has joked that Jennifer's outfits look more fitting for a night on the town, and he is particularly uncomfortable when Jennifer wears her miniskirt. Should the department manager address this? How should she go about managing the situation? Now, dress code, now this is where we get into, is this a trans issue or is this a sexist issue? Sometimes they're both, right? If you're not going to say that to another woman who's not trans, could be transphobic. If you would say that to a woman regardless, sexist. And that's where you get into, as the person working in this department, you know, what are our codes of conduct around clothing in general? Is there such a thing? And if there isn't, then we have a bigger issue on our hands. Needs to talk about culture of the department. The coworker might need a refresher training on sexual harassment, hostile climate. So some of these issues are very interconnected with issues of Title IX, sexual harassment, hostile environments. No issue is in a vacuum, right? It's the first day of the semester and you arrive to class early. A young man walks in shortly after your arrival, approaches your desk, and informs you he is a student in your class. He tells you he has a request to talk to you, to ask if he hopes you're able to honor it. He tells you his name is Alan, but that the name on your class roster, which, thankfully, no longer has to have this conversation to a degree, what do you prefer to go by? You learn that he's registered in your class as Cynthia. Alan also informs you the pronouns he prefers are they and Z. Z is going to be in your packet. It's another type of pronoun that people could use. You have a very interactive class and call in students by name, but almost always refer to your student roster for the first few weeks. You are accustomed to students preferring to be called by their nicknames. Alan looks very much like, I'm sorry, this is, it says talking, I can't read what that says. You would have never thought he was once known as Cynthia. You're also not sure you can get used to the unfamiliar pronouns. What do you say to Alan, right? So we had a coach in an IM sport where I sort of, I guess it doesn't matter, I can just say it now because I just revealed, that I adapted this from, that had a trans student come out in a, I won't say the sport, in a sport, and they wrote this student a 3-page email. We printed it out that was going into the history of their gay activism as an ally and really coming from a good place, but the letter said, I will not call you they. I will not. It's up to you to teach me and remind me, right? So this is where we keep putting the onus on the students that are already experiencing hostility. We're kind of relinquishing our responsibility as their educators, right? So Sally, a trans woman student, approaches you as a college dean. She complains that a faculty member in her major department continues to call her by her male given name and refer to her as he, even though she has asked the professor several times to use her correct name and gender. How do you address Sally, right? So these are things that people are dealing with and students are dealing with. So a lot of faculty at UCSB are struggling with trans topics, and a lot are not. So we can't assume that because we're at UCSB that the professors who, unfortunately, due to certain, you know, we have Title IX, we have all these other things, but a lot of times folks don't feel that they have to abide by those laws of sex-based discrimination, gender, which includes gender identity and expression.
Some professors have difficulty with the Americans with Disabilities Act, so.
There you go. And that's why I'm glad you said that, because no one issue is in a vacuum, right? So there's all these interconnected oppressions that are happening, and we have to also include trans people in those narratives, right? So that was probably the only section that I wanted to make sure I recovered. I want to leave a couple minutes for some questions, and if you know, we only have a couple, that's fine, and then I'll conclude with some of your takeaways. So back to questions. Any questions from you all?
You were talking about referring in the past. This is one that I struggled with before in terms of whether it's okay if people refer to Bruce Jenner as the Olympic champion in 1984 versus Caitlyn, like if they're talking in a historical aspect. I don't know, because I haven't heard Caitlyn Jenner say anything about that. That's what she prefers.
And that is a really, really thoughtful question, because I know so many people who really want to talk about someone's transition in a thoughtful way, because the reality is Caitlyn Jenner very publicly transitioned and many people are talking about it, you know, and they will for the end of time. So the Olympics are actually considering, if they haven't already, changing the historical record in their records to say that Caitlyn Jenner was the decathlete that won this and that. But that's besides the point. So the best way that I have found, even myself, talking about Caitlyn Jenner is saying something like this. So I actually have talked to a couple people who don't know Caitlyn Jenner, right? And I'll say, have you heard of Caitlyn Jenner? They're like, no. They're like, well, there is a story out right now of Caitlyn Jenner, and Caitlyn Jenner very openly transitioned. The world knew Caitlyn as a very public figure. Caitlyn was known as, you know, Bruce Jenner in the media. But that is not Caitlyn's real name, right? Caitlyn's name is Caitlyn, and her pronouns are she. She was presenting through a way that she thought she needed to, but her true self is Caitlyn, right? Versus me saying, yeah, that Bruce Jenner, right? Bruce Jenner wants to be a she now, or, you know, her name was Bruce, right? You know, this, that, and the other. Like, it's a very fine line of how you approach it. And if you're talking thoughtfully and you're using the pronouns throughout, right? And you're using the permission of the person, right? So for example, Carrie comes out to me, but me only, as trans. She tells me what her legal name was or is, right? If I start telling people that, that gets very problematic. Versus if Carrie goes on TV and says, my name, you used to know me as this, but this is my real name, right? That gives you the agency, I would think, more so than if Carrie comes out to you one-on-one for me to say, well, you know, Carrie used to be Steve, right? Right? Because Carrie was actually, if you really think about it, never Steve. Carrie was Carrie, but was forced to be Steve, because when we're in the closet, that's something that's forced upon us. People put themselves back in the closet or stay in the closet, but a closet is not designed by LGBTQ people. Closet is designed by external people to, you know, force conformity and, you know, a lack of expression. So it's a great question and it's very tricky. It's also very much based on how the person talks about themselves. If someone says you can use my former name to describe me, that's fine. But always the pronoun for sure always needs to be consistent.
Thanks.
Other questions or thoughts? I'd like to hear from a couple of you, two or three, just something you took away that you'd like your peers to know that you're carrying in your heart and mind, or new knowledge you've gained that you really want your peers to really consider, that, you know, as colleagues, even though you're all, maybe some of you are in different states, different, I don't know, countries, cities, planets, whatever, that you all are collectively moving forward with some new knowledge. So just a couple of you, something you want everyone to take away that you are taking away. Joe Sabato.
I think the one thing to always keep in mind is that as an Asian American, I don't like people telling me my experience is the same as anyone else. Mm-hmm. So keep in mind that every person has an individual experience. And so I want to treat that person, you know, to the extent. So I don't generalize saying, oh, LGBTQ folks are this, because we talk about intersectionality even. you know, even that the race is a factor, you know, the socioeconomic status is a factor. So there's, it's not just, oh, LGBTQ or this. So I try to go as much as possible to the, to make it as individual as possible and understand that.
Yeah, thank you, Joe. So there's no one way to be transgender, and we've seen through the workshop that Joe is highlighting that different types of trans people have disproportionate experiences due to intersectionality. So thank you, Joe. A couple more comments, something you're taking away or something you just enjoyed about the workshop.
This is Seth. So one thing that I took away, I live in Lompoc and it's, you know, highly conservative and a lot of ignorance here, you know, be it in my, you know, friend base or family or just community members. And so one thing I took away is just kind of statistics that I can use, ways that I can be an ally, and just kind of trying to, you know, bring the human aspect to it, especially when you're talking about risk of suicide and things like that, because I think a lot of people dehumanize with labels and things like that in their thought. And so if you bring it back to, you know, these are people and they, you know, they have feelings and needs and all that, you know, I think you can really kind of change some minds. So I found that helpful.
I'm so glad. Thank you, Seth.
Can I add on to that, Seth? I attended the memorial, Orlando Memorial, last Monday. And talking about humanizing people, when I see friends of mine stand up and say that, you know, I'm part of this community, to realize myself that these are people that I love, and these are people I like, and they, and for any one of my friends to be the target of hate crimes anywhere, anytime, really hit me. Even though it's something I think about, but when I see friends of mine stand in front of me, brave enough to say, you know what, I'm part of this community. And for me, looking at my friends, saying, you know what, and Dave said something that was really profound to me. He goes, you know what, see us today. Recognize us today, because you know what, we may not be here tomorrow. That really hit me. So I think that aspect of humanizing folks and our friends, I think that's a very important part of our work. That's why, as much as possible, that's the reason why we asked Dave to do this. You know, we're gonna ask other folks in our community to do this, because I think technology, sometimes we forget that the people that we serve are people. They have their own experience. And sometimes we forget that because we're dealing with technology.
Thank you, Joe.
That love is definitely felt and reciprocated. I hope you know that too. Any other comments or things you're taking away or you enjoy for our last call? Oh, someone's gearing up. Is it you out there?
I'm sorry. Did you ask a question? Because I had to talk to somebody.
Oh, yeah. Okay, I'll put you on the spot. I'll say just something you took away from today that you appreciated or you enjoyed about the time we shared.
Oh, well, I really appreciated it. I missed the second video, but the first video was amazing. That woman is an amazing mother, and I wish her the best during her child's puberty. And it was just, it's heartening to see somebody with that much courage.
Yeah. Thank you. And it's something that we can all take a cue from. And it's something, if we have our slide lingering up here, that we could all see that no matter what our version of courage is, that it's contributing positively as long as we're doing something. So I challenge you all in a healthy way to figure out what that is for yourselves based on your comfort, your style, your influence, and to always challenge your own selves to keep pushing that higher. So thank you all for having me for part two. I really appreciate being here with you all.
Good presentation. I don't know, I want to offer, if you have summer reading, to read a great book. It's on this subject. It's a fiction, but it's excellent. It's called Middlesex. It's a Pulitzer Prize winning novel.
Yeah.
It's excellent book. Yeah. Really well written. And it's on this subject. It's very good.
Beautiful.
So leave that with you.
Yeah, and I will be sending you all some summer reading as well. Read it when you can, but just put it on your calendars to read it at some point, and you've started your ally action. So thank you all again. Have a beautiful weekend, and continue loving each other. Thank you.